Hello everyone and welcome to Control Digital Lectures. We had concluded our discussion about limit cycles in the last video. Today, we will start a new topic, feedback linearization. So, let's start our lecture. Feedback linearization is a powerful technique for the analysis and design of nonlinear systems. The central idea of this approach is to algebraically transform the nonlinear dynamics into a fully or partially linearized system so that the feedback control techniques could be applied. If we consider a class of single input, single output system of the form x dot equal to f of x plus g of x into u and y equal to h of x, if there exists a state feedback control of the form u equal to alpha of x plus beta of x into v, and a change of state variables z equal to t of x that can transform a nonlinear system into an equivalent linear system, then all the classical techniques can be applied to the resulting closed loop system. So, the principal idea here is to cancel out nonlinearities in system by choosing an appropriate control input u. This is similar to the designing of controllers for linear system using state feedback control, where the control signal u of t is obtained as a function of the state of the system. That is, u of t is usually chosen as a function of state variable x. As a result, the system equations modifies to x dot equal to a minus bk into x of t. And the solution to the system becomes x of t equal to e raised to a minus bk into x of 0. Okay, anyways, coming to our topic, the feedback linearization can be possible in two forms. The first one is input state linearization. In this, the full state equation is linearized. That is, the goal is to cancel out the nonlinearities in f and g so that the state equation is in linear form. The second form of feedback linearization is input-output linearization. In this case, the emphasis is given on linearizing the input-output map from u to y, even if the state equation is only partially linearized. That is, the goal is to cancel out the nonlinearities in h of x so that the output equation is in linear form and explicitly tied to the input u of t. Okay, now first let us discuss about input state linearization. To introduce the concept, let's start with a problem. Consider the example of a pendulum system. If theta is the angle made by the pendulum with the vertical axis, then the differential equation of the system is given by d square theta by dt square equal to minus a sine theta minus b theta dot plus ct, where t is the applied torque and a and b are relevant constants. Now our aim is to design a controller so that the pendulum holds a certain constant angle theta d. To stabilize the pendulum at theta equal to theta d, there needs to be an offset torque applied. Let's now convert the system differential equations to state space form. But instead of using the states as x1 equal to theta and x2 equal to theta dot, let's define the states as x1 equal to theta minus theta d and x2 equal to theta dot. Therefore, the system equations become x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to minus a sine x1 plus theta d minus b x2 plus ct. Note that the equilibrium points is at x1 dot equal to 0 and x2 dot equal to 0. This gives us x2 equal to 0 and minus a sine theta d plus c t of equal to 0. We have t of here because we had already defined that t of is the torque applied when theta equal to theta d, that is at steady state. Now think of this. T of is the torque required at equilibrium. T is the torque on the pendulum at any instant. So, in order to bring the pendulum to equilibrium, we need to apply an input equal to T minus T of, right? So we define the control variable u as u equal to t minus t offset. Now from this equation we can write t of equal to a by c into sine theta d, right? Substituting this over here gives us u equal to t minus a by c into sine theta d, which gives us t equal to u plus a by c sine theta d. Plugging this value of t into the state equations gives us x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to minus a sine x1 plus theta d minus sine theta d minus b x2 plus c. Now our objective is to choose u such that it cancels out the nonlinearities in the system equations. In this particular example we are discussing, we should choose u such that it cancels out these sine terms because they are the ones which causes the nonlinearity. However, keep in mind that choosing u is a tricky task. One might need several trial and errors before arriving at a suitable u. In our example, let us choose u equal to a by c into sine x1 plus theta d minus sine theta d plus b by c. Substituting this u in the state equations gives us x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to minus bx2 plus b. In the state matrix form we can write this as x1 dot x2 dot equal to 0 1 0 minus b into x1 x2 plus 0 1 into u, that is uc minus a sine x1 plus theta d minus sine theta d. Thus you can see that the stabilization problem for a nonlinear system has been converted to a stabilization problem for a linear controllable system. Also, on comparing the control input u here with the standard form, that is u equal to alpha of x plus beta of x into v, we can see that alpha of x equal to a by c into sine x1 plus theta d minus sine theta d, and beta of x equal to 1 by c. With this modified system equations, we can proceed to design a stabilizing state feedback control as v equal to k1 x1 plus k2 x2. So the system equations become x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to minus k1 x1 minus k2 plus b into x2. And the overall value of the control input u will be u equal to a by c sine x1 plus theta d minus sine theta d plus 1 by c into k1 x1 plus k2 x2. Now let us discuss how general is this idea of nonlinearity cancellation. Clearly, we should not expect to be able to cancel nonlinearities in every nonlinear system. There must be a certain structural property of the system that allows us to perform such cancellation. To cancel a nonlinear term alpha of x by subtraction, that is alpha of x by subtraction, the control input u and the nonlinearity alpha of x must always appear together as a sum u plus alpha of x. Similarly, to cancel out a nonlinear term gamma of x by division, the control input u and gamma of x must always appear as a product of gamma of x into u. If the matrix gamma of x is non-singular in the domain of interest, then it can be cancelled out by u equal to beta of x into v, where beta of x equal to inverse of gamma of x. Therefore, we can say that the ability to use feedback linearization to convert a nonlinear state equation into a controllable linear state equation by cancelling the nonlinearities requires the nonlinear state equation to have a structure x dot equal to ax plus b into gamma of x into u minus alpha of x, where a is an n into n matrix, b is an n into p matrix, and the pair ab is controllable, and the functions alpha of x is defined from Rn to Rp and gamma of x is defined from Rn to Rp cross p, and the functions are defined in the domain D which belongs to Rn and D contains the origin. In this case, the state equation can be linearized via state feedback u equal to alpha of x plus beta of x into v, where beta of x is the inverse of gamma of x. Now suppose that the nonlinear state equation does not have this structure. Does this mean we cannot linearize the system via feedback? The answer is no. We still have a chance of linearization. This is because the state model of a system is not unique. It depends on the choice of state variables. So, even if the state equation does not have this structure for one choice of state variables, it might do so for another choice of state variables. As an example, consider this system. X1 dot equal to a sine x2 and x2 dot equal to minus x1 square plus u. We can see that we cannot simply choose u to cancel out the nonlinear term a sine x2. However, if we first change the state variables by transformation, that is z1 equal to x1 and z2 equal to a sine x2 equal to x1 dot, we can write z1 dot equal to z2 and z2 dot equal to a cos x2 into x2 dot, which is a cos x2 into minus x1 square plus u. Now we can choose u such that u equal to x1 square plus v by a cos x2. Now if you substitute this u into this equation, you can see that the equation will become simply equal to z2 dot equal to v. That is, all the nonlinear terms are cancelled out. Also, you can see that u is now in the form of u equal to alpha of x plus beta of x into v, where alpha of x is x1 square and beta of x is 1 by a cos x2. Therefore, the state equations in new coordinates z1 and z2 can be found out using these relations. That is, the new state equations become z1 dot equal to z2 and z2 dot equal to a cos sine inverse z2 by a into minus z1 square plus u. Now few things to note here are, when the transformation z equal to t of x is used, the map t must be invertible. That is, the inverse map t inverse must exist such that x equal to t inverse of z for all z belongs to td, where d is the domain of t. Next point is that since the derivatives of z and x should be continuous, both t and t inverse must be continuously differentiable. Having discussed this much, let us now formally define the feedback linearizable systems. A nonlinear system, x dot equal to f of x plus g of x into u, where f maps from d to rn and g maps from d to rn cross p are sufficiently smooth on a domain D subset of Rn is said to be feedback linearizable or input state linearizable if there exists a diffeomorphism T mapped from D to Rn such that D is equal to T of D contains the origin and the change of variables Z equal to T of X transform the system into the form Z dot equal to AZ plus B into gamma of X into U minus alpha of X with the pair AB controllable and gamma of X is non-singular for all X belongs to D. This term diffeomorphism refers to a continuously differentiable map with a continuously differentiable inverse. And by this sufficiently smooth, we mean that all the partial derivatives that will appear later on are defined and continuous. That concludes our lecture. To summarize, we have introduced ourselves to the concept of feedback linearization and have seen that it has two forms, input state linearization and input out linearization. Then we learned about input state linearization in detail, that is, when it's applicable, its standard form, its definition, etc. In the next video, we will see about input-output linearization. If you found this lecture useful, please like the video and also support us by subscribing to the channel. Thanks for watching and have a nice day.